Hello everyone, it is Sammy, the Gaming Dragon, to walk you through how to install mods using the 7 Days to Die mod launcher. I want to note up front that the mod launcher is for both Windows and Linux, with the version in the works for Mac. This tutorial is for Windows. First, we need to get the 7 Days to Die mod launcher. Open a browser window and go to 7d2dmodlauncher.com, or follow the link in the video description. Now scroll down the page and click on Download. I am running Windows, so I will click on the download link under Windows. Now that it is downloaded, open up your download folder. I prefer 7-zip, but you can use any zip program to extract the zip file. So extract that zip file to your downloads folder. For easier access, I'll move it to my desktop. Enter the folder and start modlauncher.exe. When it loads up, you'll see this window here. You will see that I have my vanilla Steam game in the list. That allows me to add modlets directly to my main install. To get this, go to Add Existing Install. It will automatically be in your 7 Days to Die folder. Hopefully, it was for me. But it won't take it if you just click Select. So you need to click on the up arrow once, click on your main 7 Days to Die folder, then click on Select to take it. If it does not go directly to your main install, you will need to navigate to that install yourself to do the same thing. Now you have your main Steam install and mod launcher to play with modlets. Let's say you want to experiment with overhauls. Click on Install and Overhaul. This will give you a list of overhauls you can install using the launcher to play. Notice down here it has the Fun Pimps in the list as well. If you click on it, then it will let you install any version of 7 Days to Die that is available from the Fun Pimps. So if you want to go back to Alpha 18 and play that version again, you can. For now, I'll just choose Darkness Falls here. You can read through the description if you want. Click on Install to install the overhaul mod. A pop-up will tell you that this will make a copy of your 7 Days to Die game, just like making another profile by copying the folders in my manual install video. But the easiest is to choose Copy from Local Install. Select your main 7 Days to Die folder and then click Copy. It will make a copy of your game install, download, and then install the chosen overhaul mod. These mods typically take a while to download, so just let it run. So to play this, just click on Play. Here it is loaded up, showing the Darkness Falls splash screen. There are no errors in loading for me, so I can now start a new game if I wish. I'm not going to right now, so I will just exit the game. Back in the mod launcher, I have decided to instead go over to my Steam install and use a simple modlet. Clicking on my Steam install, I can then click on Modlets. When you first load this page, there may not be any modlets under Available Modlets. Just click on Refresh Modlets at the top. I did this earlier off camera, and it will take a bit to find all the modlets and load them up for you, so be forewarned. If you change the drop-down from Alpha 20 mods to another version, you will need to refresh for that version as well. With them loaded, you can now scroll down through the list to find a mod that looks interesting. Here is one that I have played with before, the mining mod that will add copper and tin so you can more easily make brass instead of just loot it. I like this mod in Alpha 19, so I will install it for Alpha 20 by clicking Install. Once it is installed, you will see that it has changed to have several options. Update, disable, and delete. These are pretty self-explanatory. I will note that disabling a mod will not delete it, but it will prevent it from being loaded into a game. So it is an easier way to try different mods on one install without deleting them. A word of warning though, some mods like the mining mod will affect the map generation. So if you disable it, you may run into issues on worlds created with it. Now that the mod is installed, I will click on Close Modlets. To play with that mod, I'll just click Play. Note, regular play appears to have EAC off. If you are going to connect to a server with EAC on and the modlets allow it, click on Play EAC. So here I am loaded up into the world with the mining mod installed. I did create a new random world for this off camera just in case this one needed to be loaded in during world generation. I went into creative mode here to double check, and copper does show up in the list, so I know this mod is installed. I can now play with the mod. And that's it for installing mods using Mod Launcher. You can, of course, change your settings as you wish. Just click on the gear icon down at the bottom. With that, I would like to mention a couple of issues that I personally have with it. Number one, the mod list is small. In fact, many of the mods that I like to play with are not available in ModLauncher, so it appears only those submitted by the author to the ModLauncher dev actually gets added. There are so many more mods available than just what is on the launcher. Number 2, the modlets shown on the launcher have a very limited description. The overhauls get a large description, even a link to websites if available, but the modlets do not. As an example, here's what the NPC mod shows in ModLauncher. One line, one sentence. Now here is what you get on 7daystodie.com. So much more information that the mod author put up there, including videos on how to interact with the new NPCs. None of that is even in the ModLauncher. Not even a link to the mod page, or one of the mod sites, or 7daystodie forums. Very disappointing. Number 3, mods can get incorrectly updated. To explain further, there has been one instance I have come across while helping others, where a mod updated and deleted a file in its update as it was no longer needed. ModLauncher does not check your current install to see if any files are deleted, only if they are changed or added. This can lead to errors and player frustration. Some of these overhaul mods are huge as well. Like this Darkness Falls mod is almost 4 GB in size. If you have to delete the install and re-download it due to it not checking this, that will eat into your monthly data cap. And not everyone has unlimited data or even fast internet. Number 4, if you tried to add a mod manually to the launcher, it is downright confusing. If you go to open URL and it says it requires a link directly to the mod config XML file, which is the modinfo.xml file. This usually requires a link to the mod creator's GitHub or other repository. If the author does not list that, you just seem to be out of luck. I even tried downloading the mod manually, unzipping it, and pointing the URL to that file using the file location and the file path. It did not work. I might be able to get it to work using the file path URL conversion, but that isn't exactly newbie friendly. I will note that if you install the mod manually into the folder where ModLauncher is managing the mods, it does see it, but you cannot find updates for it, obviously. If I have to go through that hassle anyways to use mods not on the launcher, then why would I use ModLauncher rather than just learn how to install and update the mods without it? In the end, ModLauncher is great for those that may not be as computer savvy and want to try modded 7 Days to Die, or just want a program to do it for them. You just need to understand its limitations. It isn't for me, so I will continue to install my mods manually for more personal control. If you would like to learn how to install all mods manually, including having them on Steam so you can play the versions you want as you want, then click this video over here where I walk you through how to do just that. With all that said, as always, I'll see you in game.